We have a panel on DAO governance. Who should have a say? Please welcome to the stage your moderator, Femes. We also have Kevin, Alicia, and Michal. Yay!
Thank you.
Yeah.
So thank you for joining us. Thank you for joining us streaming. I thought that it was a pinnacle time to discuss about who really has a say in terms of governance. I think that there's been some misconceptions as to who has a say, and so I'm hoping with the diverse panel that we have today, we're able to kind of answer or at least open the discussion for the different rights of different stakeholders. So I'm joined today with Kevin from Boardroom, Alicia from ENS, and Michal from ARCA. I would provide this time to introduce yourselves. So, 2 minutes, if you could just, 1 minute actually, if you could just introduce yourself, that'd be great.
Hey everyone, hopefully you can hear me. I'm Kevin, I'm the founder of Boardroom. We're a governance platform, essentially built for delegates, DAOs, and different developers as well to help lower some of the UX frictions in governance, voting, delegations, et cetera, across the board, and hopefully make their lives a little bit easier. So we have a client and an API, and you can check us out at boardroom.io if you need more information.
Awesome. Hi,
we're on? I think so.
Hi, I'm Alicia.A from ENS, which is the Ethereum Name Service. I'm the governance lead, and my role is to help build out infrastructure around the DAO. The DAO is a mechanism that governs the ENS protocol and manages treasury, the treasury of the protocol. And yeah, that's kind of what I do, have been doing for the last year and a half, basically nonstop. And anyone in the DAO space knows that I mean that literally.
Hi everyone, my name is Michal. I work in a firm called ARCA. We're a multi-strategy asset manager, and there I overlook primarily our early stage investments as well as lead research into some of the new and up and coming trends and themes. And DAOs is one of my interesting hobbies, if you may call it, in the after hours. But professionally, just so happens that ARCA is one of the big participants in DAO governance.
Yeah, it's either you're in governance or you're not in governance. There's no happy medium. I'm your moderator, Femes. I lead marketing at Snapshot. I'm also the co-founder of DAO Governance Collective, which is a community of DAO govern nerds, so that we can learn together and better this ecosystem, hopefully. And so I'd actually just like to start so that we could keep a little bit grounded. Governance was something that was very exciting for many people when the DAO space was introduced. It was pinnacle. I think some of the narratives was that everybody has a say in DAO governance. So reflecting maybe over the last year and a half, how have you felt that the narrative and the actualities of DAO governance kind of have evolved, and where do you see it now?
Yeah, I can kick this off. So I think, especially when we started looking deep into DAO governance, it was around 2020 during DeFi summer, an explosion in distribution of tokens. And pretty much what had happened was that anyone who was building a token governed system was essentially not really doing any user mapping or any stakeholder mapping and just distributing governance rights to pretty much every user of the network through liquidity mining, et cetera. But there wasn't a lot of thought of, you know, about the diversity of the stakeholders, who should be really making a decision. And then during the DAO boom, because I think we saw such a development in the diversity of the types of DAOs that were evolving, not only DeFi protocols, but we started seeing, you know, social DAOs, art DAOs, et cetera. The stakeholder set really started to shift. Now it was not only DeFi users trying to getting these token rights, it was a diversity of different types of stakeholders. So there was a little bit more of an effort to try to take that into account. But to your point, over the last year and a half, I think what we've really seen is more of a delegation of responsibility to a smaller set of like managerial style stakeholders or delegates, sometimes overlapping with service providers as well. And I think we've come to the realization that realistically, not everyone's going to be too interested to run day-to-day operations in a DAO. Maybe governance shouldn't be in charge of that either. And there's been a delegation of responsibility, mostly from what we've seen, to a smaller subset of stakeholders, managerial delegates, and that are also like professionalizing themselves as well. So I think that's a really interesting topic to dive into in a little bit.
I think something that's really interesting is how crucial the initial airdrop and allocation is for any DAO. So ENS in particular is completely defined by, first of all, the distribution of the tokens and the claim process and the delegation process that we created when the DAO launched. And I think we have really leaned into this delegation model as much as possible, because we anticipated, just like I feel with my local government, you know, I'm absolutely not equipped to participate day to day, nor do I want to. Mm-hmm. It makes sense that of the, you know, over 100,000 wallet holders that receive the ENS airdrop, that a tiny slither of them may want to be actively engaged. Mm-hmm. But delegation for us was like really that model that helped just make the DAO operational, actually. Mm-hmm. To the extent that, you know, I think also how you define a DAO is really interesting. So what Kevin was saying, this idea of like, you know, the definition of a DAO can be so broad. Is it operations? Is it like the work on the protocol or the product? Is it just passing governance proposals? Mm. So I think that has also evolved, and you know, for ENS, it's, we're still in the process of like really iterating on the definition of a DAO and what that really means. So for the ENS DAO, it truly is that the DAO is simply the mechanism that governs the protocol and the treasury through proposals. That's it. And then the social environment around it is kind of forever changing.
I like that last piece you mentioned, Alicia, because if you are truly skeptic, and there are many, we always kind of encourage having a fresh view of what DAO is, was, and could be. For many skeptics, DAOs are really decentralized, autonomous in name. And I think it is very important to understand the nuance and spectrum that many of the organizations, ourselves are even involved in, really land on this spectrum. We don't have that like one ultimate DAO that everyone kind of looks up to. For us, what is very important and became really key focus of our activities in a variety of different DAOs is emphasis on token being probably one of the greatest capital formation mechanisms. Every once in a decade or two comes that mechanism, and tokens were definitely one of those, brought a lot of potential focus into how you can deploy capital to bring about a vision of a product, initiative, wherever it might be. And then with that great promise, of course, there are always irregularities that emerge. Whether they come from just the ability of execution and delivering on the roadmap, or actually keeping the governance process kind of intact and pure, original to the vision when the DAOs were set up, and then continuing with that mission as it evolves. Because these are, we have no illusion, absolutely evolving bodies, living bodies, like any organism, any corporation is. And so to that end, really the focus of ours is understanding what a potential best practice could be and what we can actually learn from TradFi. And I know too many, I might be here the proverbial wolf, big bad wolf, kind of hiding behind the stage. But in reality, what we are trying to bring at Arca is a lot of the TradFi discipline, a lot of lessons learned from a variety of different governance mechanisms that we have seen out in the wild, and some of the lessons that truly have been learned, but we're only running through that, speed running, I would say, through that experiment in DAOs.
Yeah, so that's actually really interesting, because sometimes our governance frameworks are kind of cookie cutter independent of what the type of DAO is. So Alicia, you mentioned there are social DAOs, there are protocols, there are different types of DAOs with different types of needs and different types of stakeholders. Token holders were an asset to protocols because they needed the liquidity in order to do that. And so we have this, you know, imbalance of maybe the interests of whales to those within the community who actually also power the DAO itself. And so I think maybe from learnings within the last year and a half, it hasn't been very long, how would you kind of, should we reframe governance structures dependent on the classification of DAOs? So that is to say that if we recognize that we would need large token holders in order to really sustain or allow protocols to exist, should their governance framework or their decision-making process be different than, let's say, social DAOs, which might need more human capital mm-hmm. in order to exist?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's really important to, number one, like really understand what your end goal is as a DAO. Again, a DAO is just, I mean, the governance system itself, it's just a framework, right, to make decisions in a distributed fashion online. That's pretty much it, right? We have an unlimited amount of experimentation room here. And I think what we're seeing a little bit more now, especially with the formation of constitutions and a lot of like founding documents of a lot of these DAOs, is that we're starting to pay a little bit more attention of what the end goal of that DAO is, or the set of stakeholders that are just coordinating around that framework and that system. But completely dependent on that, I think, should be the actual governance implementation itself. at the end of the day, I don't really think it's going to diverge too much into like the far edges, and they're going to be differentiated too much. I think right now we're seeing adoption of maybe 4 or 5 core systems or frameworks that are standardized, and then people are tweaking them a little bit here and there. And I think we're going to see more of that. But absolutely, I think the dependency of like what, you know, what governance system you're installing, what governance system you're using, and who should really be making decisions is completely dependent on the end goal. By the way, the same as any other governance system in the world, any other corporate governance system, et cetera, it's really all dependent on the end goal. So I couldn't agree more, yeah.
Yeah, for me, that's a absolutely yes. I think that if I was to try to analogize it, it would be that if all DAOs are animals, you've heard this, you know, judging a fish by its ability to climb a tree. So ENS DAO and MakerDAO might both be protocol DAOs, but they might have like fundamentally different missions or organizations and the structure of the DAO. And so to compare the two of them makes absolutely no sense, because you might be comparing like a fish and an elephant. They're both animals, yes, or like, you know, two different types of fish. So I think that's really important. And there's something just, you know, what you said earlier about taking learnings from different DAOs. So absolutely, and also traditional governance systems, I think that's important. But just like understanding that so many of the protocols and the projects that are, you know, doing really well in this space are very unique. And so leaning into what is so novel about them and thinking, if this DAO was, and it's kind of what I do actually, literally, I think if ENS was the only DAO that existed, and I'm really, really thinking in first principles, how would I do this based on like what I know? So yeah, I think that the classification and also just like circulating that maybe in a narrative that is easy for everyone from large token holders and whales to understand right down to like individual users, I don't think we've cracked that yet.
Yeah. Mm.
Absolutely. I think the devil is in the details, especially when it comes to the overarching mission of a DAO and what kind of offering they're trying to bring to the market. Potentially the ones that are at a pretty severe disadvantage are product-specific DAOs or service-specific DAOs that are battling out in real time in a very open, competitive environment where they're going toe-to-toe with other startups, many of which can take decision at a split-second decision or in a very small time fraction whenever you're comparing that to at least like a two-hour window. Two-week window, I wish it was 2 hours, because you need to get at least kind of the critical mass for your voting participants in order to move a strategic mechanism design decision. So for those DAOs, it is particularly important to organize internally with the kind of more natural product flows that will gel very well to the market that they're competing in. Trying to apply almost like a universal blanket mechanism to any and all. And for example, some of my favorite DAOs are absolutely the social DAOs that have certain mission and goal in mind. And they have taken much more, and I would say oftentimes a better longer term way of getting even to a token. Initially started out perhaps as a group of friends with a bunch of ideas sitting around a table, but eventually that token has to emerge. And to many, it does kind of devoid of that original vision mission. To many, it actually ostracizes or alienates some part of that original group. So as the evolving mechanism, I think it is very important to A, design your structure, and I know it's very difficult, but even Ethereum, I think, if we're looking at the underlying layer, is showcasing incredible resilience to having an overarching goal, but being rather flexible on some of the design choices along the way, and giving yourself more of an optionality to amend, adjust, and potentially pivot.
Mm-hmm. So I wanted just to touch on the idea of onboarding. So whether they're investment firms or large token holders or even community members, we're seeing an apathy in governance and a low engagement as well. In what areas within the maybe the communication stream can we implement or kind of fix or enhance in order to increase engagement? Because when it comes to tokens, they only matter when it's time to vote, right? But there's a full governance process in which people can actually participate. And so where do you find the gaps, maybe in communication or engagement? And what are some solutions that maybe you've explored or seen before that could result more better to a higher engagement?
Yeah. I mean, I guess a good question is, where do we want to increase the engagement too? Because, right, because maybe we don't need a 90% participation rate from every token holder, right? Or or you know, the individual stakeholder that's actually voting, maybe we need participation from a smaller subset of stakeholders that represent more of a voting, more voting power in the network. And I think what we're starting to see now, and again, this applies to a specific set of DAOs, not every DAO, because of course every system is diverse, but especially for the ones that have implemented delegation systems, what we're seeing is that the job of the average token holder that's delegating their voting rights away is actually to keep the delegates accountable, right? Not necessarily to like learn about every single vote that's happening, et cetera, but keep them accountable to, number one, the delegate platform, so what they're pitching themselves as and what they stand for. But number two, also keep them accountable, of course, to the greater good of the protocol, the appreciation of the token, whatever you want to call it. So right now, actually, where I see the most kind of like the biggest break in the communication stream and transparency isn't necessarily from the DAO to the decision maker, the delegate, because I think that, you know, the delegate has a massive incentive to spend 24 hours a day scouring through the forums. Mm-hmm. Where we're seeing a break in communication is the delegate to their constituents, right? So the 10,000 people that are delegating voting power to them, how does the delegate, number one, kind of like, how are they beholden to those constituents? How do they properly communicate transparently to those constituents? And number two, how do they, what's the course of action for the constituent if they want to take their power away, right? If they want to veto or whatever. So I think that's still really developing, because especially during initial claims, initial airdrops, what we saw is that, you know, people essentially were spun up as delegates from the get-go, and very little has changed in that dynamic of power, right? Maybe like 5%, 10% redelegations. But in general, kind of like those delegates are still there. So we just need better paths, I think, of transparent communication, which then lead to accountability for the delegate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when I think about onboarding, I think about the DAO, like what I said is the DAO environment being the proposal environment. It's just one environment. And the opportunity, I think, for onboarding is to create multiple different environments that are much more accessible to different stakeholders, and to engage, whether it's like developers or the community or users, in ways that maybe completely ignore the token itself. Mm-hmm. And obviously with ENS, we're really lucky because a .eth name is an NFT, and so we could use NFT names plus, say, POAPs plus, you know, whatever else there is in Gitcoin Passport, mm-hmm. to create a way for different community members to participate. And then I think that just like building and layering that kind of social capital, which I think is so valuable in the DAO space. Like, I know we talk about the financial aspects of whales a lot, but I think there is also, you know, given that we live on crypto Twitter, so it's just like a stream of stories, essentially. Like, a lot of governance power resides in people who are able to effectively communicate stories. Mm-hmm. And so just like creating opportunities for people with, you know, without the need for any funds to participate in ways that are more accessible. And then I think, you know, one of the things I'm the most proud of with ENS and the ENS DAO is how many grassroots community members are, you know, stewards of working groups or in like the top 15 delegates and things like that, truly just because they're there on the ground as like grassroots community members, like nothing to do with the balance of their wallet.
And I think on a topic of onboarding, very briefly, from even an investor perspective that takes a look at a variety of different DAOs, takes a temperature check of how engaged, how alive the given community is, and who are the kind of counterparties that turn out. Statistics are pretty brutal. When you look at kind of the average turnout vote, you know, you're lucky in many cases, you cross that 5% threshold. And that is something that beginning of that journey, as I mentioned, goes down to the heart of, is there any innovation in addition to what we're doing on the delegation front, on the voting front? Is there innovation actually in the engagement area? And I would say we are starting to see semblance of that, cautiously optimistic. Probably one of the areas that we are extremely excited is one of the very few AI and crypto crossovers where large language models are starting to play a role, very important role, as the record keepers, or the historians, if you may, of any DAOs, all of the potential history of the documentation that you are able to feed into these models, or of the voting patterns. That model is all of a sudden becomes your best friend, and you can recall it almost in like a chat, program it quite effectively in a chat-friendly mode. A couple of teams are already using and embracing that new technology. And that, in my opinion, is one of the ways you can actually see a potential turnout for user engagement versus, you know, the typical chaperone telegram at 5 a.m. Wherever it might be. Hey, you gotta turn out. You gotta sign. You gotta vote. As many, I'm sure, experience here. So, because we are living in this very native and digitally native organization, I think we should absolutely use and harness technology in order to bring more of a turnout and more engagement. And there is a really fun way to do it. Synthetics, I know, as a pretty fun little chatbot friend. I think others will follow suit shortly. And that's where some of the ideas we're excited about backing starting to innovate there as well.
Yeah, great. I mean, I think that also, like, one of the biggest gaps is in terms of relevancy, right? And I was talking to somebody about DAO governance, and they're like, well, in DAOs, like when we went to university, we had a poll, and people were more interested in like whether or not people liked cats in the poll rather than the elections, you know, for and I'm like, yeah, and it's like, will it be different in DAO governance? No, because we're humans, and we like what we like, and we pay attention to what we pay attention to. And I think that, especially when it comes to protocols, a lot of the participation within protocol governance isn't necessarily those that are mostly those that actually understand and, you know, value what is happening in there and feel like they have a say based on their expertise. Mm-hmm. And so talking about experiments that I haven't really seen a lot, maybe on a guild formation, but this idea of two-tiered governance. I know that we might have this combative relationship with large token holders and community members, but we live in the same ecosystem. And some might say, not because they're large token holders, some might say, well, these people have expertise in these particular areas, and others do not. And so we value their opinion more than others. What are your thoughts on this idea of two-tiered governance decision-making as maybe a solution or one of the solutions in terms of engagement and relevancy within DAO governance?
Yeah, it's definitely a very interesting experiment. We're seeing like little flares of it with Optimism, which is setting up their token house and their Citizens House. You know, where they have essentially like a split, right, in the demographics of who's making a decision, what decisions they're making too. Is it budget allocations, other stuff? That's pretty interesting. Another interesting debate happening in Aave as well is like what the overlap between a service provider and a delegate is, because what we ended up having is that, you know, essentially every major service provider, because the entire BD process is run through governance, became massive stakeholders, token holders, with a lot of voting power in the network, and you started to see conflicts of interest arise when it came to passing proposals, you know, granting them business contracts, et cetera, et cetera. So I think what we're starting to see is that, at the very least on the professional level almost, the folks that are really, really involved in the decision making hold a lot of power. We're starting to see that people are noticing, number one, we have to map them properly. Who's a contributor, who's a stakeholder, who's, you know, a citizen of this ecosystem, or, you know, a million other ways to kind of like split up the demographics. Gitcoin Passport's also super interesting too. Yeah. And, you know, from there, at least now we can implement the governance, we can change the underlying governance system itself to actually differentiate between those different stakeholders, which I think is gonna be fascinating. So I think that's gonna be super important. And then other cool experiments like Butter Money and others that are actually sometimes compensating, you know, different folks for different actions, et cetera, different decisions. I think that's gonna really, really evolve and professionalize over the next year. But yeah, super early stages right now.
I mean, I'm hesitant about a two-token model just from a legal perspective, to the extent that, say, ENS launched a token as a governance token for the single purpose of governance. There is absolutely no utility to the ENS token apart from to vote on proposals. That's really it. But I do think it's interesting, you know, what do people, say with this two-token model, what do people want as an outcome? Do they want governance at that proposal level, or do they want participation? Like, do they want to be engaged and active at a more community level and things like that? And I think there are ways to do that without, you know, distributing another token. I think that word is also so loaded, not only just like socially, but again, also legally. And I don't think we can really write off the legal risks around DAOs at this point in time. And so I'm really excited with ENS DAO. You know, we have working groups that are distributed funds every, you know, 1 to 3 quarters. And that basically is a playground to really try different experiments with the community and with users and builders of just like ways to engage people to actually, so you pass the proposal in the DAO, and most of those proposals relate to funding. Okay, so now you give people the opportunity to actually participate in like how that work gets done, who does that work, all those sorts of things. And I think there's just such an exciting design space there because the spectrum is so large.
It is, and boy, quite a lot of lessons again to draw from TradFi. If anything, the dual class shares are one of the most, I would say one of the least loved mechanisms out there, widely by TradFi. And that perhaps translates quite well to some of the at least ideas that we've been seeing experimented on in a DAO context. Now, I do love some of the innovation, especially as of late, trying to essentially bring about the world whereby each of those tokens are equal to one another, one token, one vote. But the additional nuance that perhaps might get introduced is not only tying the particular delegate's proposal track record to some form of reputational content, and this is again drawing in perhaps the identity layer, which we are super excited about at Arca. The other element perhaps as well, and this is again drawing kind of the parallel to the more traditional world where in finance, whether you're a venture investor, whether you're a hedge fund manager, you always have capital at risk. And with that capital at risk come, of course, the variety of different structures, whether it's carry, whether it's management fees. Those are currently absent to a lot of the delegates that are participating in governance propositions. And we do see quite a number of out-of-whack proposals. And I'm not going to quote many, but the few that that certainly kind of make you kind of sit down and take a pause is like, okay, will that proposal and following that grant allocation, will that actual proposer continue to stick around, and what is their role going to be going forward? So perhaps there is a way to capture within that kind of one token, one voter, ways to differentiate those particular shares in a way that, okay, how long have you been participating here? What are the elements of what you brought to the table? We're not there yet, and I'm like fully aware of that. But to the extent that you can differentiate, you will eventually get, I believe so, in this space world whereby we'll be able to, with a fairly nuanced manner, assess who are some of the real value contributors to these DAOs and kind of the critical stewards and fiduciaries, because I know this word is being often used, and I think it's often kind of misunderstood.
Yeah. So I want to actually just move to different stakeholders, including delegates. So Michal, I'm going to start with you. Sure. What are some of the incentives behind some of the stakeholders of the people that you work with who participate as investors or large token holders in participating within this ecosystem, coming from a more traditional financial background?
Sure. To start, and probably the simplest one we've been seeing is like paid delegates, where you ultimately have that kind of value alignment and value at risk being given to a current representative. One of the elements that we are particularly, again, kind of going to the point of how can we differentiate different levels of participation. One of the most common criticisms with any DAO, and this was Alicia was also alluding to earlier on, at the beginning of a life of a DAO, there is almost like that original sin that many investors like to quote, which is you have, as a founder, as a management team, very heavy bags going into whatever life of your DAO holds ahead of you. And now, as you bring in and grow your community, as number of different goals and sometimes even missions alter and change, there is a very potential risk of inertia brought in by that big founder block. And so if you are trying to enter as a potential investor, as a new contributor into a DAO later in a DAO's life, there is a potentially real paralysis that is, some would say, the original sin, but somehow there are also ways and methods where you could start actually indicating and managing potential roadmap and execution plans for DAO by engaging broader section of delegates. And so we are excited to kind of see several projects that are kind of working on the nexus of what is the way to engage and kind of give the mission purpose, but most importantly, alignment. And I think that is the element that using the technology, there are some very exciting ways to kind of tie each of those delegated participants to some sort of measure of objectives. And I think that's ultimately the world that we're headed towards, a lot more kind of accountability.
Yeah, so that lives on accountability on the delegates so that when people are delegating to them, then they have some sort of metrics in order to trust, I guess, who they're delegating to. Alicia and Kevin, how do you see the evolution of incentives for delegates, if not only paid?
Yeah, I mean, you know, to your point, I think it's actually right now it's really, really hard to push an on-chain proposal in like the major top 25, 30 DAOs because like quorum requirements are pretty insane. Like proposal position requirements are pretty insane. We're seeing like smaller like onboarding programs pop up where people essentially like delegate voting power to someone to propose something, et cetera. But it's exactly right. Like I think we need new systems to measure contribution, different ways to actually, you know, increase the engagement from new contributors into ecosystems. And to the point of essentially like compensation too, number one, I'm actually a big proponent of the delegates getting paid. Now, how they get paid is like the big question because we're seeing a number of different experiments around that in the space. We're seeing things that are based on voting behavior for 3 months at a time. That's Splutter that I mentioned before, or just direct payments like MakerDAO style, working groups as well, of course, where the contributors actually get compensated, but they're a little bit different from delegates. So honestly, I think right now, outside of just like different ways to measure identity and contribution, like NFTs, like social, et cetera, social options as well, I think right now we just have to figure out getting delegates paid. Like that's step one for the next 2 years. And then after that, we can try to build better systems once they have like a stable foundation, stable footing to contribute properly to these DAOs and spend the time that they're actually spending. Mm-hmm. So I know it's like a very one-sided kind of like opinion, but I think delegates should definitely be paid.
Okay, I'm gonna try the other side of the screen.
Okay.
So with the ENS DAO, delegates aren't paid. And I think something that we rely on is really making sure there is a strong narrative around why governance of the Ethereum name service is important. The fact that it's a public good, it's open source, it's intended to be a critical piece of infrastructure for not only the Ethereum ecosystem or Web3, but the entire internet. Mm-hmm. So the incentive is really what would you as a builder who is building your like identity namespace using ENS, what you know, would you give to be involved in this opportunity? Okay, you don't even have to pay us to do it, you just have to participate. But it's kind of coming like completely from the other end, instead of like we're paying people. I think trying to lean into this narrative around like people are given the opportunity to participate in the governance of, you know, a critical piece of infrastructure that would normally have just been in the hands of a single company who was the creator of the protocol itself. And yeah, I think that, you know, delegate compensation is really, it's one of those things where once you kind of create the metrics and then, you know, there are many different ways that these metrics can be hit, it almost, to me, creates like this need for more manpower to moderate and police like whether those intentions are genuine or whether people are just trying to get paid, which is cool.
Sure.
But I think we're really lucky with ENS that people will turn up because they want to participate and contribute. And I know that it's very novel for us and we're just like in a very fortunate situation. And again, like so many DAOs are so different. So what works for us, that might only work for a little bit longer or maybe it keeps working. And yeah, but I don't expect it to work for everyone.
Yeah, I mean, I also think that with payment, then there needs to be accountability,
yep.
Right? And so we also need to create some sort of structures or systems in which those that are delegating or paying these delegates to ensure that they had lived up to their focus areas or what they needed to do.
I mean, these systems already exist. I mean, this is what boards have done for 50 years, right? So like, I think we can take some of the learnings as well a little bit and apply them to some of, still maintaining, you know, our sense of transparency and diversity too.
Yeah, we didn't invent the governance wheel here, but it's definitely a new environment.
I was going to say something that's interesting about accountability is that for me, the other side of accountability is accessibility. So when you create an infrastructure that holds people accountable, for me, it basically creates an environment, like starts to create like a walled environment. And one of our main priorities is to keep ENS as accessible as possible to minimize the social structures so that it also really is a DAO. Like there's nothing that I as governance lead can do to stop a delegate from posting a proposal and it passing.
Yeah.
And so I think that is kind of the tension between accountability and accessibility.
So I'm actually just going to ask direct questions to some of you. So, and what you just said actually relates to the question that I was going to ask. So perfect. Can you share an example or instance where community input from discussions in the ENS forum has influenced governance decisions?
Yeah, absolutely. There was one earlier this year. So James Wars, who's James.eth, put forward a proposal to sell 10,000 ETH into USDC. ENS is in a fortunate position to generate revenue in Ethereum and ETH, and we pay out basically to service providers in USDC. And so that went into the forum, and then there was a Twitter space. There was like a lot of discussion from the community in the Twitter space. It was like really active in the forum, and literally like different decisions were being considered. It was really exciting, and it was basically such a great example of, for me, I think, like how this is intended to work. I think one difference with, I would say, the culture of proposals being put forward in the ENS DAO is, and actually this relates to accountability, is that I'm a big proponent of accountability of the proposer as opposed to this idea of collaboration. So when push comes to shove to, you know, putting a proposal up on telly, it really is James who decides to take the community feedback and make those decisions, because I think that at that point, like when the accountability is distributed and it becomes like this consensus environment, it all just kind of dissolves. But I think that's kind of the opportunity to create a space where people can contribute their voice and their comments, and then you leave it up to whoever's proposing to take it on.
Amazing. Have you seen any examples, you know, being in boardroom of
discussions
that really
we love the
have
drama.
Led.
We're like the neutral third party that just scans for all the drama and covers it.
I know,
all
you're the page six of governance.
I think what we usually see is definitely a lot of, like, sometimes most of the discussions go under the radar a little bit until they actually go for a temperature check. So we're actually big fans of, like, DAOs that push snapshot or off-chain temperature checks before moving on-chain, because you can actually surface a lot of issues when someone sees a live proposal in front of their face. I think fantastic examples include Lulu, like the Uniswap bridge drama that happened a couple months ago with different service providers. I'm not taking sides yet. But I think that forums are, like, I think very built for a very specific demographic, for the people that are really involved in operations or day-to-day, et cetera. Like, some have skin in the game, right, in the protocol. So what we usually see is a lot of, like, all that, the discussions on both ends really surfacing during temperature checks, which is where we really start checking data, et cetera, through our APIs and platform. And for the most part, we actually see pretty interesting engagement numbers from the temperature check. We actually see, you know, levels at 10 to 20%, especially for even the major DAOs, even though it drops drastically, right, to a smaller number of stakeholders that are honestly on-chain just ratifying the decision, right? So we see the on-chain proposal more as like the execution or ratification of a decision that's already been established by social consensus before through a temperature check or a discussion. So yeah, again, I mean, there's so much data to comb through, I get, but in general, I think we really kind of like are big proponents of that middle step, just to surface as much discussion as possible for at least a week.
Yeah. Awesome. And Michal, you, given your expertise in governance campaigns, and what strategies or approaches have you found most effective in mobilizing stakeholders, and maybe just pulling from one of the campaigns and then providing an example on that?
Yeah, perhaps the really overarching here theme for all of those engagements with a variety of different DAOs, a variety of different stages, centered around engagement with the community from the very earliest get-go, particularly not only just the teams and kind of the stewards, as you may, that overlook mechanism design and some of the more critical longer-term discussions, but more importantly also other I would effectively call them community members, some would call them essentially shareholders, that have been engaged and participated, or maybe have been just the holders and not as much of an engaged entity. With those, we really try to spend a lot of time and poll what are kind of their interest goals and aspirations, where do they feel the project really meets some of their criteria, and where maybe it fell short of expectations. And so in order for us to go through that decision matrix where we will get involved and engaged, there is a pretty nuanced way of how we essentially screen for any opportunities. Some products we've been power users from the early days, being such an active fund since 2018, and being oftentimes one of the early contributors, giving active feedback on the design mechanisms that will work for maybe institutional desks that maybe are not as important to retail. So with the campaigns and initiatives that we have taken, absolutely overarching theme has been engagement. The second one perhaps that we are trying to optimize for and to the nuisance of many DAOs out there is perhaps emphasis on transparency. Being oftentimes quite open and doing it in an open forum, but we just see it as a part of the equation of not essentially hiding behind closed doors, getting the deal done, and then bringing it to the vote. Rather, actually have that engagement very early on and have and kind of pool people that were longtime holders in those DAOs, or maybe new members that are now starting to get engaged and want to do something with us or against us, because quite frankly, we welcome debate here. We are here to make those teams and products better. And that's why, yeah, you should really think of us as a good thought partner or aspiring partner if you prefer.
Fantastic. And so actually just one question from the audience. So what are the governance implications of going from a multi-sig to a DAO? So I'm going to reframe that. You know, when starting with a smaller group, how do we see governance expanding once we bring in different stakeholders and members?
ENS literally did this. It was a multi-sig with 7 key holders from the moment it was created. And Nick Johnson, who's Nick.A, the founder of ENS, he was just one of the 7 key holders. And the intention behind creating a DAO or launching a DAO was to further decentralize the decision making related to the ENS protocol from 7 key holders to ideally, you know, tens of thousands of wallets or addresses to potentially hundreds or thousands of active delegates. And so, yeah, when people think like, is the ENS DAO successful in terms of decentralization of decision making? I mean, we went from 7 decision makers to, yeah, over 60,000 wallets currently delegating to you know, over probably like 100 really active delegates. So yeah, I think just like moving from that spectrum of like multi-sig to DAO and like what is winning, for us it was better than 7.
Yeah, no. So we're almost at time, and so I just wanted to leave with my final question. Any kind of aspirational final thoughts on DAO governance and the possibility of diversification of stakeholders? Learnings, vibes, less capital, I don't know.
I honestly think we just need better indexing of the information. So everyone always claims that like governance, because everything's transparent and open in blockchains, like everyone's going to instantly understand it, but there's like massive UX barriers to people even like understanding what activity is happening, who's voting on what, why are they voting different ways. So I just think we need like better tooling, better indexing between the layer of just on-chain activity and the end delegate state, where, you know, we can communicate us hopefully to more people and more constituents, you know, what's actually going on, so they can hold people accountable. And I think for the next 5 years, that's probably should be the focus before expanding into like insane governance models or something crazy.
Yeah, I think for me, something that I'm thinking about and will take up a lot of my mind space is just like better defining what our DAO, like the ENS DAO really is, and what is within the scope of the DAO, and then what is the social environment around it. And then being able to communicate that to the different stakeholders. And also just acknowledging that just because something is part of a social environment doesn't make it less than. I think, you know, ENS without its community of users and builders and things like that would not be the protocol that it is today. And so, and that's completely separate to token holders. So yeah, just like working on definitions and better communicating that so people don't feel so, I guess like excluded, and bringing more inclusion to everything.
And to close off, really, DAOs are our people. It is a social experiment that we are, social and financial experiment that we are speed running to. But behind every single ENS, there is a person. And that's what we found overwhelmingly when we engaged those teams and broader communities, that yes, some feelings might get hurt, others might actually welcome us with open arms. But in the end, it really is a two-way street. And so for us to participate in any governance, we absolutely want to do it in kind of collaborative manner. And that, I think, should be kind of a North Star for most of the DAOs out there. at least the ones that I'm actively contributing to in my private time. Very excited to see them kind of embracing that mission.
Thank you. Well, I mean, also you have dedicated people who are trying to solve diversification of governance or just being in governance as well, and especially in the bear market. So hopefully that's at least a testament that things will get better. Yeah, we're still here. Thank you so much for joining me, and thank you so much for joining us.